one example of the cars, no Fords or Germans. Unless you have good roads, you cannot use the cars. So, I didn't get the questions. No, what are the questions, sir?
The question is, he has raised a question that sometimes we are not convinced that we will succeed in the mission because they are not, even if they are trying to reach out to the government, they are scared that government will not listen to their issues. Am I right if I am to understand this? Yes.
I don't think
you
so.
You can ask here.
What I was talking about, we are focusing on make in India. We are luring the foreign investor to come and make product cheaper. How is it gonna, raise the image of India, you know, as a destination? Because we want to be identified as a creator. We would succeed only when we create. Otherwise, some other day, China would again come up with this yet low cost technology or something, and we would still be fighting with them.
Products can be cheaper, but it cannot be deficient with quality. As long as you have the best quality available at a competitive price, I don't see why, no reason why that make in India could not be consumed in the domestic market.
And Jay, if I could ask you, how many CEOs of what you're seeing in your approach do believe in the make in India concept? Though the discussion is not about make in India, but it still forms an essential characteristics of this discussion.
So in keeping with some of the thoughts that gentlemen also raised, there are two components to this. One is the actual fact. Would you wear Indian-made garments? Would you drive Indian cars with the same pride that you would drive an international automobile for a foreign make of an automobile? The question is, one is the actual product, and the second is the brand, the imagery. What are you communicating to the world? Would you walk out like Dr. Batra said? And I think it's a brilliant case of positioning. If you're saying, I am Indian, we are Indian, and we will represent India in a good light in wherever we are, you're speaking the same language. But these are early days. It's just the beginning. We're still plagued with infrastructure bottlenecks. We can't wish away this in a jiffy, right? But it's a beginning. So, and also what Vivek said, before you get to that, invest in your product. Make sure you develop and deliver a superlative experience. Concentrate on that and build on the brand. When we do excellent products, what we suffer from is excellent packaging and marketing. And that is something the government has to wake up to and realize that we need to address these issues. Wherever bottlenecks are there, they have to be eased. But also the right kind of consistent communication needs to happen to the world that we are a sought after maker of goods and services.
So if I could ask you, what are the trend-setting ideas that you have taken in digitalizing, in the digitalization of Dr. Batra's product abroad? And if at all you have done it, would you like to partner with companies abroad and India, maybe with him actually, to reach out to the people actually, to the wider masses? I'm aware that this cannot be sold in the online stores. Or is there a possibility that we can sell it? Because Flipkart recently tried to sell it from the prescription product and got hammered.
Well, there are two separate questions here.
Yes.
One is about products, and our products are already selling on, and my books, for example, on homeopathy, they're already selling on Amazon, they're selling on Flipkart. So that is already happening for the last few years. The other part is about treatment.
Yes.
In 1996, we were among the first people to actually start something called a cyber clinic.
Right.
So we actually made our own, website, and we said that how can you marry the click and the brick method? And therefore, we said you must have a face so that people can trust you. Otherwise, they don't want to consult you online when they can't see your face, And in a case, I can't use that, brick method. I can actually use a click method. It took a long time to develop that. At that time, there was no payment gateway either. It was very difficult to do that. Today, let me tell you that almost 20% of our entire business comes through the digital media.
It comes to the?
Digital media.
Okay.
And so we have a very strong digital presence in whether it's social media, whether it is ORM.
Can you broaden this digital means? Does it mean you do sell this in online or?
Yes, we have doctors who work round the clock, as one example. We have tied up with also I can just say this, but we haven't announced it yet.
Yes, okay.
With a large company, a telecom company, and partnered them in mHealth. So we have something which is called health response centers all over the country. And you can actually log in through your mobile phone and you can actually then talk to a doctor live. And you can pay for it depending on how much airtime you're using. So we've gone way ahead of lots of other things. And all our clinics are 24/7 networked. We can video conference with any doctor. A patient, if he's got a smartphone, can video conference from his phone to any other doctor of his choice across 375 doctors. We've used a lot of technology and a lot of digital space. It's something which has helped us hugely to not only standardize our treatments, but also to reach out to many more people and make it easy for us to manage across, you know, multiple outlets and also to scale business.
Well said, yeah. Now, this Vivek, this will be interesting to you because person of this stature and considered to be father of Indian homeopathy has started thinking of the digitalization, because when he started his business, it was nothing. He has spent years, you know, decades in this. He is at this position and is telling that he is 20% of the business do come from the digital medium. Is it a sign that you are looking could determine well in the future, actually?
Yeah, definitely. Actually, the e-commerce has many benefits. You know, you reach out to people who are not connected to you directly. You know, you can have a physical shop there, but you can cater to only limited number of audience. You know, e-commerce has that inherent ability to reach out to masses and cater to them. You know, it's not just a one-way media like TV or radio. It's like you are interacting with them. So that we see that trend. And we see that, in e-commerce also 50% of the sales is coming from tier two cities. So e-commerce is penetrating in last mile as well. So I think every business has this opportunity to leverage the power of internet.
So okay, I'll take you to the last round if I could ask. Hello. You, Jay, there now. How do you consider India's positions with China? Can India overtake China? Given the present context that China's economy is crumbling and news of India is also not good, although it is stable. So do you think India can overtake China?
In a single word, yes. Is it going to be easy? No. Will it happen tomorrow? No. But will it happen? I sincerely think that there is a distinct possibility that we will be the world's second largest economy very soon.
All right. Can I take this round with you?
Join my panelists to tell yes. The answer, yes or no question, yes. But it can happen today, tomorrow? No, it takes time.
All right. Do any of you agree with this? Okay, can I have the mic there, please? If you could, someone move into there. Can I tell my, yes, so could you please go there with the mic there, yes. Gentlemen there, yes.
My name is Gaurav Zudshi and I'm representing Money on Mobile. So Satya, when you said that can we overtake China, I also want to say convincingly yes, but when, how soon, that's a big question mark. And like I said, when they say they want to make Bombay the Shanghai of India or Shanghai of Asia, it's not that simple. Like I said, for us to even widen a road, recently I read there was like a 40 crore escalation on building a 1.5 kilometer road because it took government so long to get that kind of encroachment off and take the access to that road. So in China, they can build a whole city and redevelop and take people away from Shanghai to another new city which they build up. So we haven't built any new cities in so many years. So I think most of our big cities are crumbling with more and more urbanization and more migrant influx. So I don't know. I think our cities are dying rather than growing. But, so that's a big quandary which I have.
But your company is doing very well in terms of numbers. So
no, our company is doing very well because, like I said, we are not metro-centric. Like
we are in tier 3, tier 4 cities.
While our peer group is focusing on the carded population and the 100 million people, we are focusing on the other 900 million people. So I think that's why we have done so well in Northeast and others where even bank branches don't exist, Money on Mobile exists. So I think that was a comment. If you want to remark on that, Dr. Batra, I want to ask you a question. You said about employability, right? You said, you know, you don't believe in degrees and certificates, but more on skills. So even with the Skills Foundation coming in, have you seen more skilled people coming into workforce in your domain? Because yesterday was an appalling day for me. I read the headlines of newspaper, even though it was Ganpati and it was a very, very, very good, auspicious day. There was an article in Uttar Pradesh. There was an application for, I think, 200 or some 268 peons. 23 lakh people applied. 1:6,000 acceptance ratio, while IIT is 1:100 and CAT is 1:50. 250 people were PhDs. how overqualified were they? And then my friends were facetious. They said, "Shayad fake degree raha hoga agar PhD wala P unke liye apply kar raha hai." Or what was going through his psyche for a PhD who's had 8 years of more formal education than a matriculate and he's applying for the same job? So is there a dichotomy there, you know?
Before you could answer, Uttar Pradesh government is run by someone who is a very young Chief Minister, Mulayam Singh Yadav. In fact, he's only sitting in the chair, but his position is being, occupied by so many uncles and so many ministers, so he doesn't have the real authority. Anyway, coming back to that one, yeah.
Well, I haven't seen any change in skill development right now. And I think it'll come during a course of time. And I think, you know, the government has just started the initiative. And I think we have to give it time to actually build it up. The Uttar Pradesh thing that you said, I mean, I've actually experienced that personally in my company. We were recruiting people for front desk jobs and even for dispensers. And, you know, that was the time when the IT boom in the South had actually just, the bubble had burst. I was staying in one of the hotels and we made the mistake of having a walk-in kind of interview. I got something like 2,000 people lined up outside and it became a security issue. And ultimately the hotel had to ask me, please move outside because we can't manage so many people, you know. And a lot of the people who were there were actually IT engineers who were actually applying for a job, which is, you know, but I think when there's so much of unemployment and when the opportunity is so little, what does one do? I mean, what do you do with a degree which has no meaning? I think.
Then do you agree made in India is good for the near term? If Foxconn can come and get a land in Talegaon and employ engineers to build whatever iPhones or whatever.
Well made point, yes.
No, I'm saying, of course, it's a good idea. And it will work. The problem is that why can't we not get there? I'm saying all of us are very bullish about India. We all believe that it is a superpower. It has so much of inherent capability to get there. Why is it not getting there? I mean, personally, I feel point number one is, democracy works against us because we have to work with so many people, unlike China, which is autocratic and can actually, you know, take decisions. And the second thing is we lack political will. And I think the biggest problem today is one of strong leadership and leadership which has the will to make a difference. And until that comes across, there will be no change. Everything will be only, we'll be talking in forum, we'll be talking about things, but there's nothing going to be changed. I mean, you know that a person who wants to make a difference can actually make a difference. I mean, you get one good CEO in a company and the entire company turns around. And I think that's what is required in India. It's not just at the central level, but also at the state level, also at the municipality level. I mean, where the impact will actually be felt by a common citizen is not in the center. It's going to be at the municipality. So unless the municipality changes, unless the leadership over there becomes very strong and, you know, has a strong political will to make a difference, things will not change.
So things will not change, as Dr. Mukesh Batra puts it, is the line of the day. So with this, we conclude this CEO roundtable, which to my mind is given a mixed feeling to this audience that though there is a Make in India concept is there is a strong urge to excel in the field, but there are certain obstructions which we feel, and at the same time, there is a growing optimism that India can also be a superpower in China. But we do still see disturbing trends coming in. It has been a pleasure having with you here, Mr. Jay Kumar, Dr. Parth Sarathy, and Bibek, and Sir Dr. Mukesh Agrawal here. Can we have these mementos, you know, to present to the esteemed guests, please? Yeah, okay. I could give to Mr. Jay Kumar here. So this is for you also, one chair. Thank you. At the end of combining, we'll take. Yeah, Dr. Parsad, it's for you. This is a small token of resting for you. We have a combined rent, please. Sir, you are in the middle, actually. That was. Okay, thank you. you very much. Thank you. Wonderful having you here. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for having here for the CEO round table discussion. As Mayank Gandhi has arrived, So the next speaker is someone who could vibrate you literally, and he is in the headline for the wrong reason. I wanted actually my moderator and very good friend Jay to introduce him. I thought I'll do the task because I have understood him best. I don't belong to any political party, but he's there in the wrong side of the story by the media. And I don't know whether he's with the side of Kejriwal or he's with the side of which side. But one thing I'm sure that he is the man who thinks about the country. And he also tells me that I don't care if happens what it happens to various other things. But when it comes to the country, I'll have to think my inner conscience and I will have to execute. So ladies and gentlemen, please give a huge round of applause to Mayank Gandhi, who is the member of National Executive of Aam Aadmi Party, the person sought to fame with the India Against movement in Mumbai, followed by Jantar Mantar, and was later taken over by Kiran Bedi and Anna Hazare. Then Arvind Kejriwal played a bigger role. Let me also share with you one thing. It is Mayank Gandhi who started the India Against movement campaign in Mumbai itself, which later flourished into a big movement, and he enjoys tremendous support here in the public at large. But of late, I don't think he is very happy with the kind of progress that it has been made. So one thing is very certain, that Mayank is going to tell the real news today, I'm expecting at least, as he is talking about the very important subject, that is political maneuvering affecting the political parties and the governance in India. I am very pleased to have with me a very, very exclusive chat with you, Mr. Mayank Gandhi, for you. Thank you very much over here.
Namaste. Let's get some energy here. Namaste. Should I speak in English or Hindi? English? I remember Satya has told me I'm going to reveal something. There's no revelation. Please don't expect anything dramatic today. I'm just going to talk my heart out to you. I remember 2010, I think all of us remember. Media used to be full of stories of the Commonwealth game corruption, of the coal corruption, the 2G corruption. We used to be tired of this dynastic rule in which a Gandhi family would be the only one who would inherit the kingdom. There was unrest. We were all very apathetic. Kuch nahi hoga is desh ka. 2010 end, if somebody had told me this country will change, I would have laughed at him. Kuch nahi badalne wala is desh mein. But in 2011, Arvind came to me and told me, Mayank, maine ek bill banaya hai. Main Prashant Bhushan, Shanti Bhushan aur Santosh Hegde ne ek bill banaya hai. Jan Lokpal, jisse corruption kafi kam ho sakta hai. For 42 years, this has not been passed. It's time we did a movement. Will you please join me? Earlier, I had worked with Anna for the right to information bill, etc. I felt it was a momentous time in the history of this nation when something could be done. So, ek taraf se there was cynicism ke kuch nahi hoga. Because I remember we tried to have mobilization, we tried to have meetings on various issues of national importance, but nothing happened. 50 people would not gather, you had to send SMS to everyone. Are aa raha hai ke nahi aa raha hai, aa raha hai ke nahi aa raha hai. Nahi, aaj mera mausi ke jija ka, chacha ka, ladki ka shaadi hai, toh main nahi aa sakta hun. So in a way, there was this fear. I remember the first meeting we did at Azad Maidan, there were 20 people. But suddenly, I suggested to Arvind, why don't you include Anna? Anna would be a good person to have to lead this movement. And suddenly it just took, it took its own momentum. I remember ek message nahi gaya aur phat 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 kahan kahan se kaise kaise log aa jate the. Suddenly we had touched some nerve. This country had touched us nerve. Jo pura desh tamas mein tha, in apathy, in cynicism, suddenly became angry. Bharat Mata ki jai, Vande Mataram, road ke upar aa rahe the. So what was happening was there was a change in consciousness. People did not realize, why are we going like this? What is driving us? Why are we watching television channels for 24 hours? And I know people who used to watch it the whole night, not sleep. There was some shift in consciousness that was happening. There was passion. There was idealism. There was romanticism. There was a chance that something will happen to this country. And something did. Desh badal gaya? I don't think so. Desh pura badal jayega, jaisa Narendra Modi ne kaha ya Arvind Kejriwal ne kaha? I don't think so. Par logo ki mansikta badal rahi hai. People have started thinking differently. People who did not have the guts have started standing up. Aaj aap Mumbai ke andar ek SRA ka project aisa nahi hoga jahan ke wahan ke log RTI karke ladte na ho. Things have changed dramatically. People have become strong, they have become bold, they have become daring. And that, I think, is the real change that has taken place. The other important thing I always keep on asking, which is the biggest problem of India? Somebody would say poverty, somebody would say illiteracy, somebody would say injustice, somebody would say reservation. But the biggest problem in this country has always been leadership. We have never got a good leader, whether you go in business